as a leader, as a teacher, as a man, a philosopher, as a man who knew the facts of life, as an Africanist, as an economist, as a political scholar, as an agitator. The thing that struck me most about him was that Malcolm was a man. I mean man in a particular sense. Malcolm had created a new style for those of us who would be men to follow. Malcolm left us the heritage of manhood, which in our country has long been going out of style. And if you don't believe it, if you remember,
being here in America doesn't make you an American. Yeah. Being born here in America doesn't make you an American. Yeah. While birth made you American, you wouldn't need any legislation. You wouldn't need any amendments to the Constitution. No, I'm not an American. I'm one of the 22 million black people who are the victims of Americanism. I don't see any American dream, I see an American nightmare.
Much of what I say might sound bitter, but it's the truth. Much of what I say might sound like it's stirring up trouble, but it's the truth. Much of what I say might sound like it is hate, but it's the truth.
There's only one way to be a first class citizen. There's only one way to be independent. There's only one way to be free. Not something that someone gives to you. Something that you face. Nobody can give you independence. Nobody can give you freedom. Nobody can give you equality or justice or anything. If you're a man, you take it.
No.
If you can't take it, you don't deserve it.
We declare our right on this earth to be a man, to be a human being, to be respected as a human being, to be given the right of a human being in this society, on this earth, in this day, which we intend to bring into existence by any means necessary.
I say that a black man's freedom is as valuable as a white man's freedom. And I say that a black man has the right to do whatever is necessary sometimes to get his freedom that other human beings have done to get their freedom. And I say that you and I will never get our freedom. Nonviolently and patiently and lovingly. We will never get it until we let the world know that as other human beings have laid down their lives for freedom and also taken life for freedom, that you and I are ready and willing and equipped and qualified to do the same thing.
So he did not destroy it. We ain't work for free, see they had to employ it. Built it up together so we equally appointed. First 400 years, see we actually enjoyed it. Constitution written by W.E.B. Du Bois. Well, no reconstruction, civil war got avoided. Little black Sambo grows up to be a lawyer. Extra, extra on the newsstands. Black woman voted head of Ku Klux Klan. Malcolm Little dies as an old man. Martin Luther King read the eulogy for Ham. Followed by Bill O'Reilly who read from the Koran. President Bush sends condolences from Iran. Where Fox News reports live that Ahmadinejad wins the Mandela Peace Prize.
In Bandung, back in I think 1954, was the first unity meeting in centuries of black people. And once you study what happened at the Bandung Conference, and the results of the Bandung Conference, it actually serves as a model for the same procedure you and I can use to get our problems solved. At Bandung, all the nations came together. There were dark nations from Africa, Some of them were Muslim. Some of them were Christians. Despite their religious differences, they came together. Some were communists, some were socialists, some were capitalists. Despite their economic and political differences, they came together. All of them were black, brown, red, or yellow. The number one thing that was not allowed to attend the Bandung Conference was the white man. He couldn't come. Once they excluded the white man, they found that they could get together. Once they kept him out, everybody else fell right in. And fell in love. This is the thing that you and I have to understand. And these people who came together didn't have nuclear weapons. They didn't have jet planes. They didn't have all of the heavy armaments that the white man has. But they had unity. they were able to submerge their little petty differences and agree on one thing, that though one African came from Kenya and was being colonized by the Englishmen, and another African came from the Congo and was being colonized by the Belgians, and another African came from Guinea and was being colonized by the French, and another came from Angola and was being colonized by the Portuguese. When they came to the Bandung Conference, they looked at the Portuguese, and at the Frenchmen, and at the Englishmen, and at the Dutchmen, and learn or realize that the one thing that all of them had in common, they were all from Europe. Blonde, blue-eyed, and white-skinned. They begin to recognize who their enemy was. The same man that was colonizing our people in Kenya was colonizing our people in the Congo. The same one in the Congo was colonizing our people in South Africa and in Southern Rhodesia. They realized all over the world where a dark man was being oppressed, he was being oppressed by the white man. So they got together under this basis that they had a common enemy. And when you and I here who have been awakened today, look around us, we too realize here in America, we all have a common enemy. Whether he's in Georgia or Michigan, whether he's in California or New York, he's the same man. Blue eyes and blonde hair and pale skin. Same man, same man.
Our family stayed only briefly in Milwaukee, for my father wanted to find a place where he could raise our own food and perhaps build a business. The teaching of Marcus Garvey stressed becoming independent of the white man. We went next, for some reason, to Lansing, Michigan. My father bought a house, and soon, as had been his pattern, he was doing freelance Christian preaching in the local Negro Baptist churches. And during the week, he was roaming about spreading the word of Marcus Garvey. This time, the get-out-of-town threats came from a local hate society called the Black Legion. They wore black robes instead of white. Soon, nearly everywhere my father went, Black Legionnaires were reviling him as an uppity nigger for wanting to own a store, for living outside the Lansing Negro District, for spreading unrest and dissension among the good niggers. As in Omaha, my mother was pregnant again, this time with my youngest sister. Shortly after Yvonne was born came the Nightmare Night in 1929, my earliest vivid memory. I remember being suddenly snatched awake into a frightening confusion of pistol shots and shouting and smoke and flames. My father had shouted and shot at the two white men who had set the fire and were running away. Our home was burning down around us. We were lunging and bumping and tumbling all over each other trying to escape. My mother, with the baby in her arms, just made it into the yard before the house crashed in, showering sparks. I remember we were outside in the night in our underwear crying. Then he moved us into another house in the outskirts of East Lansing. In those days, Negroes weren't allowed after dark in East Lansing proper. There's where Michigan State University is located. After the fire, I remember that my father was called in and questioned about a permit for the pistol with which he had shot at the white man who set the fire. I remember the police were always dropping by our house, shoving things around, just checking or looking for a gun. The pistol they were looking for, which they never found, and for which they wouldn't issue a permit, was sewed up inside a pillow. My father's .22 rifle and his shotgun, though, were right out in the open. The image of him that made me proudest was his crusading and militant campaigning with the word of Marcus Garvey. As young as I was then, I knew from what I overheard that my father was saying something that made him a tough man. I remember an old lady grinning and saying to my father, "You're scaring these white folks to death." One of the reasons I've always felt that my father favored me was that, to the best of my remembrance, it was only me that he sometimes took with him to the Garvey UNIA meetings, which he held quietly in different people's homes. There never were more than a few people at any one time, 20 at most. But that was a lot in someone's living room. I noticed how differently they all acted, although sometimes they were the same people who jumped and shouted in church. But in these meetings, both they and my father were more intense, more intelligent, and down to earth. It made me feel the same way. I can remember hearing of Adam driven out of the garden into the caves of Europe. Africa for the Africans. Ethiopians awake.
Ethiopians awake.
My father would talk about how it would not be much longer before Africa would be completely run by Negroes. By black men was the phrase he always used. No one knows when the hour of Africa's redemption cometh. It is in the wind. It is coming one day like a storm. It will be here.
We of the Universal Negro Movement Association are raising the cry of Africa for the Africans, those at home and those abroad. There are 400 million Africans in the world who have Negro blood coursing through their veins, and we believe that the time has come to unite these 400 million people for the one common purpose of bettering their condition.
Malcolm went to Africa.
The teachings of the late Marcus Garvey.
Marcus Garvey. Why do they engage in this form of harassment? They engage in such harassment because the American government wants to turn you against your own kind in order to keep you from making a mass exodus out of this country back to your own country where you can live among your own kind. So the American propaganda is designed to make you think that no matter how much hell you kept here, you are still better off here in America than you would be elsewhere. This is their trick. They want you to think you have no place else to go. And many of our so-called Negro intellectuals who told that our leaders and our spokesmen actually believe that our people have no place else to go. And so this type of leader can only offer a solution designed to make us stay here and continue to catch hell patiently in the hope that someday the white man will have a change of heart and recognize us too as human beings and then accept us into his white society. You never will have peace here. You never will have security here. You never will have hospitality from white people here. You'll spend another 1,000 years exposed to the hypocrisy and false promises of the white man.
You'd be surprised. We discovered that deep within the subconscious of the black man in this country, he's still more African than he is American. He thinks that he's more American than African because the man is jiving him and the man is brainwashing him every day, telling him, you're an American, you're an American. Man, how could you think you're an American and you have never had any kind of American treat over here? You have never.
Okay, your nigga back again. To my fans was handing in. Straight out of Atlanta, but I'm proud to be African. Let's blow another pack again. Blow another wreck again. Till I call a friend and I'll blow out another pack again. Ask her where she heading to. Told her that I'm following. I say I'm Liberian. She say she's Somalian. Then we started partying. Convince her that we staying in. One time for the Nigerians. Shout out to my lady now. Watch how you approach me, dude. Reppin' for my heritage. That's what I'm supposed to do. Tell them who the real is, dude. Ask them who the ill is, dude. Murder any beat I get. Blackout like a villain's dude. And I'm here to soda block. Send them here, I hear more rap. Eat them seeds and spit them out. You just made the menu pull. That means you're a corner black. Diss us and we rhyming back. Wait a second, make some noise. Where the fuck is Ghana at? Come on, throw them hands up. Let me hear you say it loud. This one's for my Africans. Let them know we black and brown. Wait until my shit blow up. Let me see those fists go up. They held us down for long enough. Let me see you lift us up.
Malcolm traveled extensively in Africa, Ghana, Nigeria, Uganda, Kenya, Liberia, Senegal, delivering countless fiery speeches, telling the African about the plight of the Afro-American.
Y'all could never check us, dude. Show you what respect could do. Throw whack rappers in a bowl. Eat them like a pepper soup. Better yet, they foo-foo dog. That means that they super soft. I see you, your top is down. You see me, my roof is off. Yeah, I know your love and style. And I know it's been a while. Shout out to my nigga Boo and Akande from Senegal. Nigga, get it right. There's a line that you don't cross. You a weakling, listen, peaking. Now you fucking with a boss. To all of my South Africans. Shout out to Johannesburg. The World Cup ain't gonna save the world. Get away and pass the word. I'm hoping that I'm reaching them. I ain't trying to preach to them. All the Ethiopians. Shout out to Eritreans. Shout out to Angola, dog. All of my Zairians. Bars up to the Cote d'Ivoire. Let them know I'm hearing them. Now I know they're fearing it. They make it so you hate yourself. Learn about
about your heritage. You're with your creation.
New bridges must be built. Because in the minds of the majority of our people today, Africa is too far away. So the only way you and I can point them in that direction is build new bridges. We have to have the type of understanding of Africa and the type of understanding of our people here in order to build a bridge, a contact, a line of communication between the two. And once the lines of communication have been established and our African brothers can stretch forth their hands and reach us, and we can stretch forth our hands and reach them, why, there's nothing that this blue-eyed man in this country will be able to do to you and me successfully.
The Cadence.
Freedom singers were singing the song Oginga Odinga, because Oginga Odinga is one of the foremost freedom fighters on the African continent. At the time he visited in Atlanta, Georgia, I think he was then the Minister of Home Affairs in Nairobi, in Kenya. But since Kenya became a republic last week, and Jomo Kenyatta ceased being the prime minister and became president, the same person that you are singing about, Oginga Odinga, is now Kenyatta's vice president. He's the number two man in the Kenya government. And the fact that you would be singing about him, to me, is quite significant. 2 or 3 years ago, this wouldn't have been done. 2 or 3 years ago, most of our people would choose to sing about someone who was, you know, passive and meek and humble and forgiving. But Oginga Odinga is not passive. He's not meek. He's not humble. He's not nonviolent. But he's free. He's free. Oginga Odinga is vice president under Jomo Kenyatta, and Jomo Kenyatta was considered to be the organizer of the Mau Mau. And I think you mentioned the Mau Mau in that song. If you analyze closely those words, I think you'll have the key to how to straighten the situation out in Mississippi. When the nations of Africa are truly independent, and they will be truly independent because they're going about it in the right way, they will give the historians, will give the President Kenyatta and the Mau Mau their rightful role in African history. They'll go down as the greatest African patriots and freedom fighters that continent ever knew, and they will be given credit for bringing about the independence of many of the existing independent states on that continent right now. There was a time when their image was negative, but today they're looked upon with respect, and their chief is the president, and their next chief is the vice president. And I have to take time to mention that because, in my opinion, not only in Mississippi and Alabama, but even right here in New York City, you and I can best learn how to get real freedom by studying how Kenyatta brought it to his people in Kenya, and how Odinga helped him, and the excellent job that was done by the Mau Mau freedom fighters. In fact, that's what we need in Mississippi. In Mississippi, we need a Mau Mau. In Alabama, we need a Mau Mau. In Georgia, we need a Mau Mau. Right here in Harlem and New York City, we need a Mau Mau. And I said, with no anger, but I said with very careful forethought,
I somehow never thought then of the black people in Africa. My image of Africa at the time was of naked savages, cannibals, monkeys, and tigers, and steaming jungles.
I was fucking these Arabs, assalamu alaikum. Niggas sit back and watch these crackers overtake them. About 1,000 years before the white man jumped in the game. He was selling off niggas and he's still doing the same. What a shame. Got your ass praying 7 times a day. Face in the dirt like a motherfucking slave. Got you trapped in his oil fields, hungry and desperate. Sun beating down and the water is precious. What sign of the sovereign little life of a king? Got a personal slave and he ain't even 13. And this ain't ancient history. stand up, shit is urgent.
History had been whitened in the white man's history books, and that the black man had been brainwashed for hundreds of years. Original man was black in the continent called Africa, where the human race had emerged on the planet Earth. The black man, the original man, built great empires and civilizations and cultures while the white man was still living on all fours in caves.
Gotta get past religion. You ain't a Muslim, damn sure ain't no Christian. Rahel is Muhammad, a black slave trader. Fuck the Quran and all your motherfucking traitors. Like Allah gon' save you, shitty enslaved us. So why is you calling me out, player hater? A million man march, fuck Farrakhan. Didn't mention shit about Africa, that nigga done. We some naive people when it comes to religion. Minority thinkers, others make our decisions. We some spiritual beings, the Muslims are political. Use the shit against us, explore the error is.
So wanting brotherhood and wanting peace and wanting all these other beautiful things, we had to also face reality and realize that we were in a racist society. Racism was what we were confronted by. So we knew that this was a problem that was beyond religion, and we formed another organization that was non-religious. And this organization was called the Organization of Afro-American Unity.
They got a war on our culture. Still to this day, they invading our border. Why you looking to Gaddafi, the leader of revolution? He's an Arab imperialist, ain't got no solution. That's the only way to get shit solved. Fuck all this prayer, motherfuckers, get involved. They're enslaving in Sudan right now, right now. Human cash cows on the market, shit is foul, said loud. I'm black and I'm proud, I don't fuck with no mother. Got my people in the desert looking crazy and struggling. When it comes to them Arabs, I'm downright disgusted. They're on the same level with them crackers, can't be trusted. African, you ain't a Muslim. That ain't a way of life, nigga, that's a hustle. You African, you ain't a Christian. Nigga, get your race right then.
At the international level in 1964, up until 1964 and through 1964, what the device that they use, they send well-chosen black representatives to the African continent, whose mission it was to make the people on that continent think that all of our problems had been solved. They went over there as apologists. I saw some of them, trailed some of them, saw the results that some of them had left there. But their prime mission was to go into Africa, which is a most vital country to the United States interest. So these Toms, you're not supposed to call them Toms nowadays, they're Suyans. So these uncles were sent over there.
The cadence.
So don't bother the man. He's doing his job. He's gonna put you on TV so you can get investigated. So these Toms don't go to Africa actually because they want to explore or learn something for themselves, broaden their scope, or communicate between their people and our people over there, but they go primarily to represent the United States government. And when they go, they gloss things over. They tell how well we're doing here, how the Civil Rights Bill has settled everything, and how the Nobel Peace Prize was handed down. Oh yeah, that's how they tell it. Actually, they succeed in widening the gap between the Afro-American and the African. The image that they leave there of the Afro-American is so obnoxious that the African ends up not wanting to identify with it or be related to it. And it is only when the nationalist-minded, African nationalist-minded or black-minded Afro-American goes abroad to the African continent and establishes direct lines of communication
and let the African brothers over there know what is happening over here.
Say what's up to all my folks back home in the States.
What's up?
So y'all all hit to what RBG's about? Okay, all right, that's what's up.
All right,
so y'all gonna say, well, bye-bye, yo.
We love you.
Yeah, we really want
to see you back home.
Beautiful.
RBG for life.
Yes, sir.
Malcolm X, I want to talk with you briefly about your affiliation with Kesha. How long have you known him?
About 3 years.
And have you been advising him as far as his religious affiliation?
Well, no, I don't give advice to anyone. He's my brother and my friend. I express what I know and understand around him, and then, but he has a mind of his own, an understanding of his own.
And every time we watch television, they show us Tarzan and the natives and the jungles. They never told us that Africans were more intelligent than we are. They speak English, French, and African. We can't even speak English to them.
And our beautiful brothers, the Mau Mau, who were patriotic soldiers fighting in defense of Kenya, their homeland. When the white man would go to them with his pole and say, "You belong to the Mau Mau?" They said, "I ain't never heard of the Mau Mau." You know, the white man is so naive, he actually expected that African to tell him that he was one. And the one who so faithfully told Boss, "I never heard of him, Boss," he got Boss's head when Boss went to bed. And so I tell him the same thing here in America. When he run around asking black people, "Are you a Muslim?" Our people say, "I never heard of him, Boss." And that's what he wants to hear. Tell him just what he wants to hear. "I never heard of him, Boss." Rock him to sleep. Send him to bed. Now, if I was Cassius Clay, I'd make that rhyme out. But I'm not Brother Cassius. So I think I'll let it stop right there.
This mid-20th century is Africa's. This decade is the decade of African independence. Forward then to independence. To independence now. Tomorrow, the United States of Africa.
Nationalism is the wave of the present and the future. It is nationalism that's bringing freedom to oppressed people all over the world.
In the darkest hour, when the world has turned away and no one's watching, when the sky has turned gray and you have no options, when your voice is illegal, only choice for the people is to stand up proudly in the face of death. It ain't a waste of breath when you speak up loudly on behalf of the kids in the street with no pot to piss in, living on their own cause their pop is missing. Don't know if he's dead or he's locked in prison. Disappeared, they consider him the opposition. And now I'm having visions and dreams I shouldn't see. Like, could we be this close? Nah, I couldn't be. But if the people in Egypt and Tunis could do this, decide they fake, then why wouldn't we? More than 40 years, he done brought the nation under occupation. We cannot be waiting, we gon' stop debating. When one of us dies, 10 jump in line ready to box for Satan.
It was nationalism that brought freedom to the Algerians. It was nationalism that brought freedom to the Nigerians and to the Ghanaians. It was nationalism that brought freedom to the people of Uganda and Tanganyika and Sudan and Somaliland. The Africans didn't get it by sitting in.
Fathers cross the scars through to the children, they're shooting to kill them. But the question I'm asking is, who's gonna heal them? Look up to the clear skies, then down to the ground where the blood, sweat and the tears dried. We are questioning their lies, realize death is not a threat when the fear dies. So we are not afraid anymore. We can't play God with our lives. You attempted to cage every thought, but resistance is locked in our minds. From real bank to tower to Tahrir Square, nobody can deny us. We're there and we are not leaving till we have got freedom. We are willing to bleed and even stop breathing. You must have known from the rust on your throne that you couldn't maintain by cutting the phones. Justice alone will sustain our prisons. Tunisia to Libya, Bahrain to Yemen.
The Africans didn't get it by sitting here. They didn't get it by waiting here. They didn't get it by singing "We Shall Overcome." They got it through nationalism.
us greater than God. Go ahead
and you and I will get a new nationalist.
You were just a man.
Taste the blood, I done taste the sweat, I done taste the tears, I ain't taste regret. I done taste the blood, I done taste the sweat, I done taste the tears, I ain't taste regret. Now I'm a grown man, ain't never seen my homeland. Ain't been closer than the Magic Jack phone plan. Dad escaped jail and he dedicated his life to the cause, but he never made it. This ain't about my father getting retribution, or my uncles getting tortured with electrocution. Other uncles getting hung in public executions, just simply coming up with the best solution. And I don't know why it seems this guy's regime keeps pushing through the silent screams. Won't take you half an hour to figure that this coward can only get his power through violent means. Killing all the doctors in the hospital when the regime just seems so unstoppable. When freedom feels like it's impossible, the people rising overcome every obstacle. You can't take our freedom.
One of the things I noticed when I was in Africa traveling around, when a man is sad over his miserable condition, he does nothing to change it. Sadness doesn't change anything. It's only when he gets mad that he changes. It takes madness to change it.
Take from the people, give straight to the serpents. The sick place that this earth is will only ever change if changed for a purpose. By the people, for the people. None are supreme, all are equal, there's mountains to touch. The power is us, devour these cowards, it's out what they rush. I am not a leader, a teacher, a preacher, my people aren't free then. I am not either, refuse to be silenced. And we will not stop short of removing these tyrants. There comes a time to summarize, events can't summon the lies, nothing is quite as tense. Look up to the sky and wonder why you're next. You could call this the butterfly effect. I despise the rats that disguise the facts when they know the population is fighting back. Inside of crack, this time it's bad. Like the second boy, it's easy to light the match. You can't take
our freedom. The Kikuyu got mad. They just didn't care what the consequences were. They knew they cared nothing about legality, morality, or anything. All they knew was that they were being oppressed unjustly, illegally, immorally. And because of this unjust, illegal, immoral oppression that they were suffering, they came to the conclusion that they would be within their right to bring it to a halt by any means necessary. And they adopted those means. So these Toms, actually they succeed in widening the gap between the Afro-American and the African. The image that they leave there of the Afro-American is so obnoxious that the African ends up not wanting to identify with it or be related to it. And it is only when the nationalist-minded, African nationalist-minded, or black-minded Afro-American goes abroad to the African continent and establishes direct lines of communication and lets the African brothers over there know what is happening over here and know that our people are not so dumb that we are blind to our truth and its position in this structure. Then the Africans begin to understand us and identify with us and sympathize with our problems.
City, my city, where we go hard and survive is the fact, cause we never had much. Took it overseas from season, still out of touch. Return of the prodigal son, still second to none. Flashbacks, how it all begun before the sucker free video stage is massacred. Barefooted in the streets of Africa, listen to Rock Kid. Let your rock stage, you're making it out here. Take it back home, and you wonder what the corn being ambassador for. The red, gold, green, black star is that for. Crush the continent, I know the pumping it. The old wise man once told me something like Obio, Papa, Nathan, Akumim, Abu Bekawa, Nathan, Timim, Kaisa, what's up from the Ryanko Baku, Kiana, boy from Bastor, messing around, put the internet. National vocabulary, you need subtitles, holler at me. This is the future, we salute ya. We'll see beside you, must kill up in Lakuti. Blitzes, bridging the gap, fortune to listen to rap. Playing a gender with a fedora. Yo, the breath, the fresh air you waited for. Not the same old suckers on the radio. Yo, they need to get the weight up, no pun intended. I don't even check for haters, I'm above the standard. My name is place, the bitches brew to get us through. I'ma get the business too. Show the whole wide world how far we came. Spit, cause I'm African. What?
This organization was called the Organization of Afro-American Unity, or the OAAU. On the African continent, the imperialists, the colonial powers, had always divided and conquered. They had practiced divide and conquer. And this had kept the people of Africa and Asia from ever coming together. So on the African continent had appeared an organization known as the OAU, or Organization of African Unity. And this had been put together by a group of highly skilled African intellectuals and politicians. And it was designed to make the African heads of state, who had been kept apart and divided from each other by differences, petty differences,
personal differences, this organization provided an atmosphere in which these heads of state could submerge their differences and work together in areas where they could agree toward a common objective. And since we in America were confronted with the same devices, tactics from our enemy, we decided to call ours the Organization of Afro-American Unity, which would be designed after the letter and spirit of the Organization of African Unity. In fact, we considered ourselves an offspring of our parent organization on our mother continent. I spent 5 months in the Middle East and Africa, primarily for the purpose of getting better acquainted with them and making them better acquainted with us, giving them a first-hand account of our problem, what our problem actually consists of. When I first got there in July, I found some of them difficult to talk to. But by the time I left in November, I didn't find anybody difficult to talk to.
He made 2 trips to Africa that year. And though his concern still centered on blacks in America, he was now seeing the problem in international context.
When I was in Africa, I noticed some of the Africans got their freedom faster than others. Some areas of the African continent became independent faster than other areas. And I noticed that in the areas where independence had been gotten, someone got angry. And in the areas where independence had not been achieved yet, no one was angry. They were sad. They stood around and talked about their plight. But they weren't mad. And usually when people are sad, they don't do anything. They just cry over their condition. But when they get angry, they bring about a change. When they get angry, they aren't interested in logic. They aren't interested in odds. They aren't interested in consequences. When they get angry, they realize that the condition that they're in, that their suffering is unjust, immoral, illegal, and that anything that they do to correct it or eliminate it, they're justified. And when you and I develop that type of anger and speak in that voice, then we'll get some kind of respect and recognition and some changes from these people who have been promising us falsely already for far too long. So you have to speak their language. The language that they were speaking to this Hamer was the language of brutality. They were beating us. The two Negroes, they weren't at fault. They were just puppets. You don't blame the puppet, you blame the puppeteer. They were just carrying out someone else's orders. They were in someone else, under someone else's jurisdiction. They weren't at fault. In a way they were, but I still won't blame them. I put the blame on that man who gave the order. And when you and I begin to look at him and see the language he speaks, the language of a brute, the language of someone who has no sense of morality, who absolutely ignores law, you and I then learn how to speak his language and we can communicate. But we will never communicate talking one language and he talking another language.
You motherfuckers wanna dress this revolution up. You wanna dress it up. You want a revolution where you can kick your motherfucking feet up and be comfortable. Revolution is wrong. Do you understand what I'm saying? Revolution is wrong in its purest motherfucking form.
Revolution is wrong. Revolution is wrong. Revolution is wrong.
Revolution is wrong.
Revolution is wrong.
It's your brother,
Saul Rod. Revolution is wrong.
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 revolution is raw, we ain't trying to debate. For the last 400 years, it's been a mistake. These white motherfuckers got us caught up in fate. And I ain't referring to just the black race, I'm talking about the whole world. Man, religion's off the chain. Every time I turn around, they saying God is a man. Talking about his son and how he walked on his earth and how he falling out the sky for the rapture of the church. Crack a please, crack a food fat. Lining these kids need to stop it. What a food fat. Lining these kids need to stop it. And no, I'm not gonna drop it. I'm glued to this topic. Zooming motherfucker real close, microscopic. Ain't no pussy popping lame niggas get to walking. They don't wanna hear it when a real nigga spitting like a samurai sword down the middle. Watch me split them. It's the verbal slum lord. Country jungle when I roar. Bloodthirsty like them crackers. Revolution is raw.
Look at the American Revolution. In 1776. That revolution was for what? For land. Why did they want land? Independence. How was it carried out? Bloodshed. Number one, it was based on land. The basis of independence. And the only way they could get it.
I'm a changed man, everything about me ain't the same. Who's to blame, man? Paranoid and feeling kinda strange. They done forced English on us, and they done changed our name. I'm referring to them crackers, the original whip gang. No honor, no shame, no remorse, just pain. They done proved they'll hang a nigga, burn him in flames. And they ain't with that Jesus shit, so bitch, stop playing. He can't save you from the truth no matter what y'all saying. Get it poppin' like Hannibal Barker, the Punic Wars. I'll show you how to crank this shit up and get it. Revolution is raw, it's time to handle some beers. Stop acting all scary, nigga, it is what it is. Ain't talking about racism, talking about restoration. Fuck them 40 acres and a mule, that ain't reparations. Talking to my nation, get your ass off the seesaw. Marcus Garvey, get our own country, nigga.
You haven't got a revolution that doesn't involve bloodshed. And you're afraid to bleed. I said you're afraid to bleed. Long as the white man sent you to Korea, you bled. He sent you to Germany, you bled. You bleed for white people. But when it comes time to seeing your own churches being bombed and little black girls murdered, you haven't got no blood.
Nigga, step, step, nigga, march. If you're doing that for them white folks, nigga, you retarded. Give your ass a little freedom, but you still work the hardest. You know we the smartest, and they always trying to be us. But you caught up in they Jesus, they don't even believe. Christianity, now you rolling up your sleeves, right? Nah, young nigga, don't fight, go get a book. Cause you ain't research a damn thing, nigga. Look, born a black man, under white authority, and elected as a deity by the Roman majority. I know y'all brainwashed, so listen up and follow. You being hypnotized with them lies of the Bible. And I don't need to split seas, no mountain recitals. I just need to plant seeds for my people's survival. So wake your ass up off the wall like Michael, and get your bitch ass back on track like Michael.
I'm telling you, you don't know what a revolution is. And when you find out what it is, you'll get back in the alley. You'll get out of the way. Revolution is based on land. Land is the basis of all independence. Land is the basis of freedom, justice, and equality. The white man knows what a revolution is. He knows that the black revolution is worldwide. How do you think he'll react to you when you learn what a real revolution is? You don't know what a revolution is. If you did, you wouldn't use that word. A revolution is lust. Revolution is hostile. Revolution knows no compromise. Revolution overturns and destroys everything that gets in its way. And you sitting around here like a knot on the wall saying I'm gonna love these folks no matter how much they hate me. No, you need a revolution.
Revolution is wrong, nigga!
Brother Cadence.
Follow me, where bloody bodies lay. And don't forget you saw it first inside of Haiti gates. Black America cowards, pop a bottle often. You just don't know you might be next inside a FEMA coffin. Ancient the word behaving, a bilegal noose. Don't trust all niggas screaming conscious, some be fair and rolling. This should teach you something besides a talk of sober. Don't get comfy cause your money might be worth shit tomorrow. Haiti, they wait to die in Port-au-Prince.
of hunger. Red cautious, new cold killer, white supremacy, who don't it? Bombing catastrophic, exercise of cold dead and ocean. The United States of Murder Masons encore. Daddy died under the building cause the earth explode. The French city did it because of old dissension. That's a lean and his boys never knew no competition. It's on to the next story cause hate is getting boring. Let's worship white America in all her guts and glory. Let's watch the Super Bowl and cry about the crack of Jesus. Cause them Africans in Haiti, friends who are voodoo demon Haiti. We watch our people suffer and think our family's safe. The blood they shed keeps us alive till it's our time to pay. Hope niggas wake the fuck up before the next emergency. They'll have another movie scene and an encore. Haiti! Revolutionizing war at a computer desk. The cracker uses gun. There's no niggas left. Replace his Bible with a bullet, baby. Help yourself. We all Africans. We're forced to win by magic. Cast bell shots inside the top of your oppressor's cabbage. They're watching us to see who got the guts to test them. The beast will move again. His movies always send a message. Haiti. Centuries of loss. Black fatalities. Learn to lock and load, thank you God for your enemies. American pie, mass destruction, knocked on Haiti's door. 200,000 takes a quick sheet face, encore. Haiti!
Most of the family Christian, but most of the homies Muslim. Me and him be talking while I'm puffing, so I'm nothing. This is my dream, when I'm sleep, that's reality. No formality, back to the essence gradually. I don't trust religion, it's a few people mad at me. See you on the other side, where we can build happily. I stay low, but I roll so high. I don't need new friends, some old ones die. I seen a dollar bill can make close friends hard to swat. Love, Lucha Kiss, those are both my hearts. Brothers from other mothers, other fathers, but same father. Put the hoodies on, fuck the umbrellas, let it rain on us. We can tell you that the sun gon' shine, but if you in a dark alley, the chrome gun gon' shine. You can see it, even fake jewels shine. That's why the industry niggas that let the fake dudes sign. I ain't bitter cause the shit is so sweet. I have nightmares of drowning cause my shit is so deep. Probably from the ocean floor, but I'm a fire sign. Yeah, I'm on my sad shit, breaking down my ghost of y'all. Space ghost, phantom shit, cannon in the cannabis. Gun came from Germany, we Los Angeles. You ain't gon' eat if you ain't put a hand in this. You ain't on no mob shit if you ain't on no family shit.
How can you and I be looked upon as men with black women being beaten and nothing being done about it? Black children and black babies being beaten and nothing being done about it? No, we don't deserve to be recognized and respected as men as long as our women can be brutalized in the manner as that this woman described, and nothing be done about it, but we stood around singing, "We shall overcome."
Had that altercation, screaming in my face, he should've known I wouldn't take it. Should've been long gone, but the fighter in me faced it. I tried to calm him down, really man, I tried to save him. I even called his people like, "You better come and take him. You better come and get him, but he end up on the table, fighting for his life, for his toe tag with a label. Never put his hands on me again, man, life gone. And I never regret my whole life long. 'Cause he did it to himself, all the fault was his. I don't feel bad, that's just what it is. Should've known better, speaking to me like a kid. Should've just let go, would've let him live. Would've let him live.
'Cause I didn't mean to hurt him. Could've been somebody's son. And I took his heart with him. I pulled out that gun. Rum pa pa bum, rum pa pa bum, rum pa pa bum. Man down. Rum pa pa bum, rum pa pa bum, rum pa pa bum."
And when I listened to Mrs. Heyman, a black woman, could be my mother, my sister, my daughter, described what they had done to her in Mississippi, I asked myself, how in the world can we ever expect to be respected as men when we know that we will allow something like that to be done to our women and we do nothing about it?
Machines, what you expect me to do? If you're playing me for a fool, I will lose my cool and reach for my firearm. I didn't mean to lay him down, but it's too late to turn back now. Don't know what I was thinking, now he's no longer living, so I'm about to leave town. Yeah.
If you do it to him, he'll bust your head. And what's good for the goose is good for the gander. Remember that. What's good for the goose is good for the gander. Do you understand what I'm saying? What's good for the goose is good for the gander. Let him know that the price you have to pay when he pats your woman is either the loss of his hand, or the loss of his arm, or the loss of his head. And if you go to jail for taking his head, you went to jail for a good cause. You can go to prison. I came here because I defended our black women from the filthy paws of that blue-eyed white man. Yes, I'm seated and I mean it. You can go in hotels around here and find these white men laying up there with black women. Why, you should snatch off their heads. I mean, snatch off their heads. You and I will never be respected until we get some respect for this black woman.
You don't know. Don't tell me Negro, that's nothing. What were you before the white man named you a Negro? And where were you? And what did you have? What was yours?
First she had on baby clothes, then she had young lady clothes. Mom tried to keep out the sexy clothes, prom night she won't dress it close. Took her all night to get ready for retro, now she won't 80s clothes. No colleges, no scholarships, so she put on some navy clothes. Pregnant now it's bigger clothes, delivering I'm back in liquor clothes. Different girl when the liquor flows, stripper name, stripper clothes. Stripper pose on stripper pose, then take off her stripper clothes. Right in front them gigolos, cocaine where she stick her nose. Burnt out, turned out, bulldog, now she walk around in niggas clothes. Out that sad, out that bad, Goodwill got to give her clothes. Oh, the humanity like that burning dirigible. Richard Pryor lit on fire, she can't tell what fit no more. And
you can't have a positive attitude toward yourself and a negative attitude toward Africa at the same time. To the same degree that your attitude, that your understanding of an attitude toward Africa becomes positive, you'll find that your understanding of and your attitude toward yourself will also become positive. And this is what the white man knows. So they very skillfully made you and me hate our African identity, our African characteristics. And you know yourself that we have been a people who hated our African characteristics. We hated our head. We hated the shape of our nose. We wanted one of those long dog-like noses, you know.
Injected like a virus from TV screen to your iris. You buy what you are provided with, whatever your size is. You lay it flat, then iron it. And if you fight it, it's like David versus Goliath. 'Cause that skin, you're supposed to hide it, dress it up and deny it. Can't even go natural no more, 'cause if you do, you probably won't get hired. So tell me who's lying. If I am, I'm lying on the ground, but I'm flying, and they still trying to find me.
It's like every day you change.
We hated the color of our skin. hated the blood of Africa that was in our veins, and in hating our features and our skin and our blood, why we had to end up hating ourselves, and we hated ourselves. Our color became to us a chain. We felt that it was holding us back. Our color came to us, became to us like a prison, which we felt was keeping us confined, not letting us go this way or that way. And the psychological reaction to that would have to be that as long as we felt imprisoned or chained or trapped by black skin, black features, and black blood, that skin and those features automatically had to become hateful to us. And it became hateful to us.
Look at you, putting all that poison in your hair. You've been in prison too long, because everybody on the outside counts. Why does everybody on the outside count?
Because they don't want to walk around with a nappy head
looking like... Looking like what? Like me? Like a nigga? Why don't you want to look like what you are? What makes you ashamed of being black?
Interest, you understand. For about the next year, I just, you know, she never would have dreamed I was even thinking about it. Sister Betty X. Tall, brown skin, darker than I was, and she had brown eyes. I knew she was a native of Detroit, and that she had been a student at Tuskegee Institute in Alabama, an education major. She was in New York in one of the big hospitals' school of nursing. She lectured to the Muslim girls in women's classes on hygiene and medical facts. One day, I thought it would help the women's classes if I took her, just because she happened to be an instructor, to the Museum of Natural History. I wanted to show her some museum displays having to do with the Tree of Evolution that would help her in her lectures. When I mentioned my idea to Sister Betty X, I made it very clear that it was just to help her lectures to her sisters. I'd even convinced myself that this was the only reason. Then, by the time of the afternoon I said we would go, well, I tell her so I told her I had to cancel the trip, that something important had come up. She said, well, you should have waited long enough to tell me, Brother Minister, I was just ready to walk out the door. So I told her, well, all right, just come on then, I'd make it somehow. But I wasn't going to have much time. While we were down there, offhandedly, I asked her all kinds of things. I just wanted some idea of her thinking. You understand, I mean, how she thought. I was halfway impressed by her intelligence and also her education. I got to turning it over in my mind. What would happen if I just should happen sometime to think about getting married to somebody? For instance, Sister Betty X. Although it could be any sister in any temple, but Sister Betty X, for instance, would just happen to be the right height for somebody of my height, and also the right age. I was so shocked at myself when I realized what I was thinking, I quit going anywhere near Sister Betty X or anywhere I knew she would be. If she came into our restaurant and I was there, I went out somewhere. I was glad I knew that she had no idea what I'd been thinking about. I studied about if I just should happen to say something to her, what would her position be? Because she wasn't going to get any chance to embarrass me. I had heard too many women bragging, I told that chump, get lost. I had too much experience of the kind to make a man very cautious. I wasn't about to say any of that romance stuff that Hollywood and television had filled women's heads with. If I was going to do something, I was going to do it directly. And anything I was going to do, I was going to do my way. And because I wanted to do it, not because I saw somebody do it or read about it in a book or saw it in a moving picture somewhere. I told Mr. Muhammad when I visited him in Chicago that month that I was thinking about a very serious step. He smiled when he heard what it was. I told him I was just thinking about it, that was all. Mr. Muhammad told me that he thought Sister Betty X was a fine sister. If you're thinking about doing a thing, you ought to make up your mind if you're going to do it or not do it. One Sunday night after the Temple 7 meeting, I drove my car out in the Garden State Parkway. I was on my way to visit my brother Wilford in Detroit. Wilford, the year before, in 1957, had been made the minister of Detroit's Temple No. 1. I hadn't seen him or any of my family in a good while. It was about 10 in the morning when I got inside Detroit. Getting gas at a filling station, I just went to their payphone on a wall. I telephoned Sister Betty X. I had to get information to get the number of the nurse's residence at this hospital. Most numbers I memorized, but I had always made it some point never to memorize her number. Somebody got her to the phone finally. She said, oh, hello, Brother Minister. I just said it to her direct. Look, do you want to get married? Naturally, she acted all surprised and shocked. The more I have thought about it, to this day, I believe she was always putting on an act, because women know, they know. She said, just like I knew she would, yes. Then I said, well, I don't have a whole lot of time, she better catch a plane to Detroit. So she grabbed a plane. I met her foster parents who lived in Detroit. They had made up by this time. They were very friendly and happily surprised. At least, they acted that way. Then I introduced Sister Betty X at my oldest brother Wilford's house. I had already asked him where people could get married without a whole lot of mess and waiting. This was the 14th day of January 1958, a Tuesday. We weren't far from Lansing where my brother Philbert lived. I drove there. Philbert was at work when we stopped at his house and I introduced Betty X. She and Philbert's wife were talking when I found out on the phone that we could get married in one day if we rushed. We got the necessary blood tests and then the license. Then we went to the Justice of the Peace. An old, hunchback white man performed the wedding, and all the witnesses were white. Well, you're supposed to say all the I do's we did. They were all standing there, smiling and watching every move. The old devil said, I pronounce you man and wife, and then kiss your bride. I got her out of there. We drove right back to New York together. The news really shook everybody in Temple 7. Some young brothers looked at me as though I had betrayed them, but everybody else was grinning like Cheshire cats. The sisters just about ate up Eddie. I never will forget hearing one exclaim, "You got him!" It's like I was telling you, the nature of women, she'd got me. That's part of why I never have been able to shake it out of my mind that she knew something all the time. Maybe she did get me.
You should Google the Amaro, then the Afro, then the Euro. Anything for that green. It's a scam, it's a scheme.
My personal political philosophy is black nationalism. My personal economic philosophy is also black nationalism, which means that the black man should have a hand in controlling the economy of the so-called Negro community. He should be developing the type of knowledge that will enable him to own and operate the businesses and thereby be able to create employment for his own people, for his own kind.
Certain parts of the wheel, you can get your blood spilled on the concrete. You're a 17-year-old nigga doing foul in the hood, on the prowl out in these streets. I done been in the same situations, heartbeat racing. You come up or you don't eat. I done had to sleep in the train station, going stop to stop with no place to pay. Paper chasing, filling out applications for weeks, just trying to get up on my feet. But they ain't hiring, so a nigga was forced to resort to the street just to make ends meet. It's called survival. My struggle continues. If it offends you, let me remind you, we all have instinct to do what we have to do to make it through. And this driver's primal, whether you at Mickey D's taking an order, or coming from Florida, transporting a quarter, or on the corner. We all got needs, I gotta feed my son, he gotta feed his daughter. Now I ain't no capitalist exploiter, but I know the rules of supply and demand. Whoever control the product, control us supplying. Well, hey, that's the law of the land. Make your own stimulus plan.
What is it that makes it difficult for the philosophy of nationalism to spread among the so-called Negroes? Number one, they think they have a stake in America. They think they have an investment in this country. What we do? We invested 310 years of slave labor, every day of which your and my mother and father worked for nothing. Not 8 hours a day. There was no union in that day. They worked from sunup until sundown, from can't see in the morning until can't see at night. They never had a day off. And on Sunday, they were allowed to sit down and sing about when they died, they wouldn't be slaves no more. When they died, they wouldn't be slaves no more. They'd go up in the sky, and every day would be Sunday.
Nobody thinks slavery was just about race. Slavery was about money. They say the USA was founded on freedom. Slavery built this country. Jefferson, Lincoln, Hamilton, Jackson, Grant, all slave owners. And even today, from Clinton to Bush, they running the same game on us. They so-called war on terror, just a ploy to get more cheddar. De Niro, the root of all evil. They come in, bomb and shoot and exploit the people and call it freedom. It's a cold game, and it's the same from the top of the food chain all the way down to the little homie in the street gang slinging cocaine. That's how they do things. It's the American way, imperialism. Have it your way, whatever it takes. Whoever get fucked in the process, that's okay. That's how they do. So you can't blame us. Them dead white men on that paper ain't us. We still got to hustle for the benefits, man. My grind is my stimulus plan.
Our people not only have to be re-educated to the importance of supporting black business, but the black man himself has to be made aware of the importance of going into business. And once you and I go into business, we own and operate at least the businesses in our community. What we will be doing is developing a situation wherein we will actually be able to create employment for the people in the community. And once you can create some employment in the community where you live, it will eliminate the necessity of you and me having to act ignorantly and disgracefully, boycotting and picketing some factor someplace else, trying to dump him for a job.
What is money? Throughout history, man has used money of one form or another as a tool for living. Today, we use colored pieces of paper.
My pockets is a cemetery full of slave owners. I behave deranged cause I'm still a slave for them. I wrap them up in rubber bands, the bank is where I store them. I try to not work for them, but I can't ignore them. We warring over dollar bills with pictures of the White House. If I don't go and get them, they gon' turn my mama lights out. Even gamble with them when the homie pull them dice out. Soon as I get paid, I'm going to buy something right now. Pockets start to burn, I don't even like to hold them. Get this prize that wants to buy everything they owe me. Education realist Satan, Xbox, and the Rover. Maybe a couple of pair of Jordans just for my composure. Show me something new, and you knew I got to have it. Sometimes to the point, I ain't got no cabbage. And the next day, master, I mean money, talking to me, saying, go and start working for me. And it's funny.
Oh, yeah, man, I'm getting that new watch with the diamond on the top.
The bartenders would let me know which among the regular customers were mostly fronts, which really had something going, which were really in the underworld with downtown police or political connections, which really handled some money, and which were making it from day to day, which were the real gamblers, and which had just hit a little luck, and which ones never to run afoul of in any way.
To make a dime, my grind, something you can't see with the human eye. I don't spend chips on rims, shoes for the ride, I break bread for Tim's, boots stay tied, get more green and limes. Never see me in VIP, I'd rather be with my people outside. Won't catch me with a fancy chick, eyes on my laminate. These birds got life messed up, I can't handle it. If you impressed by bling, then you stupid, cause that nigga live in unit 203. Wow, it's a reality check. I'd rather give my salary to charity than rock a noose on my neck. Look out for family instead of losing respect. Use it or lose it, you can't take it with you in death. So why you stomping the small, trying to get large loot? Ain't nobody listening, cause they can't afford to.
We use money simply to provide us with our individual needs of life. Food, clothing, and shelter. As well as the luxuries, whatever form they might take.
Gotta have a nickel.
Yeah, man, I've been eyeing this new necklace.
The latter were extremely well known about Harlem, and they were feared and respected. It was known that if upset, they would break open your head and think nothing of it. These were old times. Not to be confused with the various hot-headed, wild young hustlers out trying to make a name for themselves for being crazy with a pistol trigger or a knife. The old heads that I'm talking about, such as Black Sammy, Bub Hewlett, King Padmore, and West Indian Archie. Most of these tough ones had worked as strong-arm men for Dutch Schultz, and there seemed to be an understanding that these Negroes and the tough black cops never clashed. I guess both knew that someone would die. Someone would die. Someone would die.
Fuck the police.
Any nigga that ever looked at me wrong owes me money or ever said any jealous bullshit about me is fucking dead.
Nigga, if you gangsta, the gold shooter crackers. Better yet, a pig or the redneck bastards. I don't give a fuck about the keys you sold, or that chain that you're wearing, or the money you fold. You a coward and a bitch, my name stay in the streets. Motherfuck the police that keep banging on the beats. You're an NBO ho, I dig around the faggot. Yeah, nigga, you ain't the truth, get the truth, you black bastard. Lick it in my system, my mom says bang him out. Drop squad behind me with the things to make her blow it out. Hurricanes, the floods, earthquakes, the oil spill. My mind is playing tricks, I must have took the fucking red pill. Skull and bones on your shirt, belt buckle in your pants. Freemasons, the Illuminati, watch the way to shake your hand. Take it in your ass just to make it to the top. 6 degrees of separation all the way to Hancock.
The seriousness of this situation must be faced up to. I was in Cleveland last night. Cleveland, Ohio. In fact, I was there Friday, Saturday, and yesterday. And last Friday, the warning was given that this is a year of bloodshed, that the black man has ceased to turn the other cheek, that he has ceased to be nonviolent.
Let me tell you about this bitch I know. She the dirtiest bitch I know. She done fuck every nigga I know. At least one time. She ride around all day looking for something to snatch. Picky bitch, she prefer browns than blacks. Picture this, corner store, liquor store around 12 o'clock. A nigga walked out looking shell-shocked. I guess he knew it too, shit, it's soda drop. Before his can hit the ground, he was up the block. But she loves when they play hard to get. She acting like she don't always get dick. Trust me, this the worst pussy you could ever hit. And if you do, she probably gon' wanna fuck again. Oh, so he hit the fence, she put a bright glow on him. As he persists, the sweat started to show on him. She told her homegirl she got a hot stud. If they wanna meet him, they needed to hurry up. Shit, they all came through thick. Bitches in blue dresses, no crap.
So today, when the black man starts reaching out for what America says are his rights, the black man feels that he is within his rights.
when he becomes the victim of brutality by those who are depriving him of his right to do whatever is necessary to protect himself. And an example of this was taking place last night at this
nigga just minding his business on the highway, trunk full of chickens. She spot you roll past, she turning around, see you with your flag, flagging you down, frantic. The bitch will even hold up traffic on your behalf, shit. It could really get tragic, the bitch love the attention. In and out of jurisdictions, got her mouth open to stick your dick in. She got the worst hair you can imagine. She call it foreplay, I call it sexual harassment. She pulled a dude over at the next exit, took him out your car, damn near started sexing. Hands by his testicles, asking him questions like,
Mr. McKenzie, you ain't learned your lesson? You been a bad boy, so I'ma really have to fuck you. And I'ma get kinky, I'ma even handcuff you.
At the same time in Cleveland, where the police were putting water hoses on our people there, and also throwing tear gas at them. And they met a hail of stones, a hail of rocks, a hail of bricks. A couple weeks ago in Jacksonville, Florida, young teenage Negroes were throwing Molotov cocktails. Now, Negroes didn't do this 10 years ago. But what you should learn from this is they're waking up. It was stones yesterday, Molotov cocktails today, it'll be hand grenades tomorrow, and whatever else is available the next day.
You know me. I am the original.
The cadence.
And the time has come for the prey to become the predator in order to survive. Rest in peace, Malcolm Shaw, Oscar Grant, Sean Bell, and all the other brothers and sisters who were forced to make an early entrance into the Ogun. This we do in remembrance of you. For Black Wall Street, Rosewood, and that damn Jim Crow. 400 years, sweat and tears, I'ma do the yellow. Tyrese Miller, Rodney King, Redneck, Popo. I'ma kill me a cracker, I'ma kill me a cracker. If these crackers wanna trip, I'ma let my thing rip. If these crackers wanna trip, I'ma let my thing rip. If these crackers wanna trip, I'ma let my thing rip. I'ma let my thing rip. I'ma let my thing rip. One call, bring them all. Wet brown, move me out, boot them all. Coming after y'all, Debbie Africa. One shot, and the cracker bites the dust. Yeah. Straight to hell, brother Herman Bell. Yeah. Blow up shit to Hugo Pinnell. Yeah. R.I.P. brother Warren Wells. Yeah. Ain't no crackers in y'all about swell. Yeah. Rich up dome with that tone for my brother Reggie Rose. Since y'all disrespect this homie, sit your ass where you and low. No more marching yeah. down this street. Yeah. No more killing yeah. another G. Yeah. I do you, yeah. I do you, me. Yeah. I kill your ass. Yeah.
With Rockwell's presence in Alabama causes harm to come to Dr. King or any other black person in Alabama who's doing nothing other than trying to enjoy their rights, then Rockwell and his Ku Klux Klan friends would be met with maximum retaliation from those of us who are not handcuffed by this nonviolent philosophy. And brothers and sisters, if you and I just realize that once we learn to talk the language that they understand, they will then get the point. You can never reach a man if you don't speak his language. If a man speaks the language of brute force, we can't come to him in peace. Why, good night.
Visions of Malcolm X are staring at me. Malcolm X put a hex on my future, someone catch me. I'm falling victim to a revolutionary song, the Serengeti's clone. Back to put you backstabbers back on your spinal bone. You slit your disc when I slit you my dish. You wanted to diss but jumped on my dick. Grown man never should bite their tongue unless you eating pussy that smell like it's a stale plum. I got my finger on the motherfucking pistol, aiming it at a pig. Charlotte's Web is gonna miss you. My issue isn't televising. You ain't gotta tell the wise how to stay on beat because our life's an instrumental. This is physical and mental. I won't sugarcoat it. You'll die from diabetes if these other niggas wrote it. And everything on TV just a figment of imagination. I don't want a plastic nation. Dread that like a Haitian. Why you motherfuckers waiting? I'll be off the slave ship, building pyramids, writing my own hieroglyphs. Just call this shit high power. Nigga, nothing less than high power. Five star dishes, food for thought, bitches. I mean, this shit is Huey Newton going stupid, you can't resist his high power. Throw your hands up for high power. Visions of Martin Luther staring at me. If I see it, how he seen it, that will make my parents happy. Sorry mama, I can't turn the other cheek. They wanna knock me off the edge like a fucking widow's peak.
And she always told me pray for the weak, them demons got me, I ain't prayed in some weeks, dear Lord, come save me, the devil's working on. He probably clocking double shifts, so none of his jobs. Frightening, so fucking frightening, enough to drive a man insane. I need a license to kill. I'm standing on a field full of landmines doing the moonwalk, hoping I blow up in time. Cause 2012 might not be a fucking legend, trying to be a fucking legend, the man of mankind. Who said a black man in the Illuminati? Last time I checked, that was the biggest racist party. So get up off that slave ship, build your own pyramids, write your own hieroglyphs. Just call it shit high power. Nigga, nothing less than high power. Five star. Who said a black man in Illuminati? Last time I checked, that was the biggest racist party. Last time I checked, we was racing with Marcus Garvey on the freeway to Africa to play my party. And I want everybody to do my autopsy, so you can see exactly where the government has shot me. No conspiracy, my fate is inevitable. They play musical chairs once I'm on that pedestal. Frightening, so fucking frightening, enough to drive a man insane, a woman insane. The reason Lauren Hill don't sing, the Coco bang loaded that clip and just said,
what was the cadence?